Good morning and welcome to the sixth meeting in 2021 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. The first item on our agenda is to take evidence from the Auditor General for Scotland on tracking the impact of COVID-19 on Scotland's public finances. Audit Scotland recently published a report on this important topic, which members have received copies of, along with a note from the clerks and a private briefing paper from the Financial Scrutiny Unit in Spice. Can I welcome Sharon Dowie, MSP, Deputy Convener of the Public Audit Committee, who is joining us for this session as our committee may wish to undertake future work on the report. We are joined for today's evidence session by Stephen Boyle, Auditor General for Scotland, and Mark Taylor, Auditor Director, Audit Scotland. I intend to allow around 90 minutes for this session, and I welcome our witnesses to this meeting. Before we open up to questions from the committee, I invite the Auditor General to make a short opening statement.
Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning, members. I'm really delighted to be with you this morning to say a bit more about our work, our submission to your consultation on the 22-23 Scottish Budget, and say a bit more about our own briefing paper that you referred to in your introductory remarks, Convener. In August of this year, I provided a submission on your call for views on Scotland's public finances. In this, I highlighted the issues that the Scottish Government should consider around the impact of COVID-19 and how these will affect Scotland's people, Scotland's financial sustainability, and the priorities that the Scottish Government and the Parliament will choose to implement in future years. The four harms of COVID-19 for the people of Scotland are complex, and trends will need to be carefully tracked by the Scottish Government and the resources in the budget allocated appropriately to prevent a widening of inequalities. The pandemic is also extremely challenging for the stability of Scotland's public finances. The Scottish Government's response in future will require effective planning for recovery and renewal over the medium term. It will be difficult to match spending to available funding in coming years. The Scottish Government will need to make difficult decisions in ways that minimises the disruption to individuals, public bodies, public services, and ensures that value for money is maintained. Understanding the longer term pressures facing the Scottish Budget becomes increasingly important. The Scottish Government will also need to be clear on its priorities following the pandemic and how these align to spending plans and the delivery of the national outcomes. To achieve its goals, decision-making processes must be transparent and coordinated with other levels of government. In our response, I highlighted some of the areas where I consider the committee's scrutiny could have most impact. These include how the Scottish Government manages changes to the budget in year, linking spending to people's well-being and financial plans for the transition from the response to the recovery phase. We'd be, of course, happy to discuss these with the committee. Lastly, Convener, earlier this month, we published the third in a series of briefing papers tracking the impact of COVID-19 on Scotland's public finances. It highlighted the scale of spending on COVID-19 to date, around £9 billion in 2020-2021, and the scale of some of the ongoing financial challenges facing the Scottish Government. The response to the pandemic, therefore, will be the backdrop to not only the budget process for 22-23, but also the planned UK and Scottish multi-year spending reviews. This year's financial position will also continue to change, with remaining uncertainty over this coming winter and beyond. At Audit Scotland, we'll continue to audit the response to the pandemic, and we're committed to supporting this committee and other committees in this Parliament. Convener, Mark and I are delighted to be here and look forward to answering the committee's questions this morning. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the opening statement, and in time-honoured fashion, I will start with some opening questions before opening up to colleagues around the table. So, first question I would ask is, you've said that, commenting on your own report, that, and I quote, transparency around what is classed as COVID-19 spending across government portfolios remains challenging in a fast-moving and unpredictable environment. Can you give me an example of where spending is ambiguous and could be better explained?
I'll do my best, Convener, and I'm sure Mark will wish to contribute as well. I think what we look to do in our briefing paper is to track some of the scale of spending. So we set out, you know, some of the sums involved, over £9 billion, but also some of the processes that have been used over the course of the year, individual spending announcements. And at the end of July, we were up to 300 individual spending announcements. Majority of those have been in the previous financial year. Some of the numbers are still to be entirely audited, and we're in the midst of that process at the moment. In terms of kind of how that translates to budget management and budget reporting, it becomes much more complex. So the allocation against individual lines on the budget has been a matter of judgment that Scottish Government officials have had to deploy to say which line best fits that. And for the most part, that will be clear whether it's health-related spending or local government. But there will be some cases that the judgment will need to be applied, and Martin wished to say a bit more about that. What we try to illustrate in the briefing paper, Convener, is the scale of change and volatility and just how challenging that can be to manage. What we're hoping as we emerge from the pandemic is that there is an ebbing of the volume of announcements, but it doesn't detract from the fundamental point of the need for transparency, just given the vast scale of spending that has taken place in recent months, that's clear as to what has been COVID-related activity and what is other parts of Scottish Government expenditure. But I'll maybe ask Mark if he wishes to say anything more.
Yeah, it's really about how, we're really asking how that can be improved, that process.
Thanks, Auditor General. Thanks, Convener. I guess three things briefly from me, Convener, just to add to the Auditor General's remarks there. I think one of the things that can be improved and the Government's working on is what I'd describe as classification. So, as Auditor General says, at high level, it's clear where money's going and what some of the high-level activity has been, and much of that is clearly COVID. Things that sit below the waterline, if you like, within individual directorates and within individual DG families, where a lot of the budget management happens at a lower level, it's a lot more difficult to identify the classification of COVID spend. And the government's, as you'll see from our report, undertaking an exercise currently to work through that. I think that's important because there's been political commitments about how COVID funding will be used, and I think it's important that the government can demonstrate that through the time. So absolutely needs improvement there, and there's work going ahead on that. The other two things just to draw out. One is around the change in the nature of spend through time. So we're very much coming out of, from a spending perspective, what has been the immediate response, and the government's beginning to plan for some of that recovery stage. And as we go into the recovery stage, what is investment in recovery from COVID from what is investment in public services and the economy becomes much more ambiguous, and that will be an increasing factor, again, where there's political commitments to spend COVID money on particular things, for you as a committee to be able to unpick that, and I think there's some scope for improvement in that area. I think the third area that I'd flag up is recognising that COVID funding is largely non-recurring. And there's something for you as a committee to consider about how clearly that's been applied to non-recurring spending areas, and a risk that because the money is very much clear will be in a non-recurring and then is applied across government, is how much expenditure is that stocking up on a recurring basis. Now, we don't have the work, we've not done the work to get into that area yet, and we'll look to try and do that later in the year, but there's an underlying inherent risk that money that comes on a recurring basis, a need for clarity about how that's applied. Thanks, Convener.
Okay, thank you for that. And I mean, I'm trying to get a kind of handle on this, because I think this is fundamental to the whole issue that we're actually talking about in terms of knowing where public money is actually going and how it's being spent or invested, however you wish to describe it. And again, you've said in determining budget proposals, the Scottish Government will need to have a clear understanding of how it plans to transition from its initial financial response to more of a recovery phase. But then you talk about continuing uncertainties in the course of the pandemic and the likelihood to maintain a flexible approach to financial planning. How can Scottish ministers grapple with that? Because, you know, at one point you're looking for more certainty in terms of understanding the transition, but at the other time you're trying to enable flexibility. How do we kind of square that circle?
I think the first thing I would say, Convener, it's incredibly difficult. I mean, I think it's important to acknowledge that this is the circumstances that we are in. You know, as we are still in the midst of the pandemic, and not out of that, you've seen the scale of some of the funding announcements that have still come through, the scale of additional public spending from what we have recognised as being the baseline exemplifies that. We're in the midst of a really volatile environment. And whilst recognising that, we also say that, I guess, two points I would make is one is that there is a need for continuing and improving transparency around how the budget has been managed. We've previously welcomed some of the additional mechanisms that have been used, particularly the summer budget revision process, and how that has supported some of that transparency. And obviously we've had, you know, in addition to the two other cycle of budget revisions, I think there is still thinking to be done about how further transparency could help, and whether that's part of the committee's own thinking about are there other steps in intervening periods across the annual cycle that might support some of that budget transparency. And the other point that we'd make similarly is part of the transparency is that the committee will maybe recall that my predecessor and I in this role have been in discussions and calling for a kind of a wider suite of public financial reporting in Scotland, notably a set of Scottish public sector accounts that sets out in a much clearer picture beyond the Scottish Government consolidated accounts what Scotland is spending, what its income is, the scale of assets and liabilities, as we think that we're keen to see progress on that front. And the last thing I'd say, in terms of looking to the longer term, convener, there's much talk about the need for medium-term financial planning, setting out the scale of volatility. And none of that, of course, brings any immediate certainty or predictability, but it's a good place to start in terms of indications of what spending plans might look like, whether it's 5 years or whether it's progressing with the work that the Scottish Fiscal Commission have indicated their intention to do into next year and beyond of much longer-term thinking. Again, we'd welcome that. None of that detracts from this is still a very volatile environment, convener.
Yes, I mean, you've actually said, and I quote, the UK position is a source of uncertainty for the Scottish budget. And then you go on to say the Scottish Government has been informed of £175 million to be allocated. However, these consequentials will not be confirmed until the UK Government's supplementary estimates are published early in 2022. So what kind of difficulties does that present for the Scottish Government?
I'll happily kick off on that one again. Mark may want to say a bit more about it too. In itself, yes, it's a challenge about the scale of change in the budget. In the wider scale of some of the changes and additional funding that has happened, it's one of the examples of the uncertainty that have been faced. So we had some similarly in the Scottish budget management in last year's budget cycle through the very considerable sums of Barnett consequentials that came through, and at varying times of to what spending announcements and then how that translated into concrete certainty. The timing of some of those announcements too that we capture in our briefing paper, similarly, some of those came through right at the end of the budget process, and the Scottish Government and the UK Government came to an arrangement to allocate that into UK reserves for the Scottish Government to become available later in the year. I think it's just an example of uncertainty coupled with whatever may come out of the spending reviews and the budget processes across the UK and the Scottish governments. But I'll ask Mark to say a wee bit more about the estimates process.
Thank you. I guess where I'd start is, of course, there's uncertainty over the amounts involved and therefore how that translates about how much money there is available to spend and the timing of that coming through, given the Scottish Government has the challenge of managing an annual budget process, a degree of flexibility between 1 year and the next, but some plans already in place about how some of that money will be carried forward. So the amount that comes through, the uncertainty over that. I think more of the challenge is almost in the classification of the funding in two ways. One is the obvious split between resource, capital, financial transactions and the like, and where money can be used, and uncertainty about how that might move around through the year, both in terms of additional funding and how much more, but also there's been a history, if we look back not too far, where the actual capital spend at a UK level was reduced from what was planned, and therefore there was a reduction in funding as a result of that. So there's that uncertainty over how the money's batched up. I think the other thing to reflect is the government's made some commitments to use certain Barnett consequentials for certain purposes. So the most obvious one of those is health, where health money flows through the system, the government's committed to apply it to health purposes. I think one of the challenges that the government's faced around that and that may continue to face has been where there's been an expectation of money coming, but it's not clear what badges or what labels attach to that money. It's difficult to know from a government perspective how much to commit that money to particular areas where subsequent events might change the nature of where that funding's come from. So some of that is inherent in the system, and some of that comes from the way government's chosen to make commitments and chosen to manage its money, which gives an extra layer, an extra degree of difficulty and complexity for it to manage.
And you've talked in the report about how, although the pandemic is, addressing the pandemic is obviously, was obviously a priority, the Scottish Government shouldn't really deflect from some of its longer term goals, such as, for example, addressing climate change. But some of the measures to actually tackle COVID would not help in terms of dealing with climate change. So one thinks of the huge and the thousands of tons of PPE equipment, for example, you know, are going into a landfill or whatever over the last 18 months. So how can the Scottish Government address that? Because clearly the number one issue is the pandemic. So how can it respond more effectively in terms of dealing with the longer term issues of climate change, but without having to compromise on addressing some of these issues in relation to the pandemic?
At the risk of repeating myself, Convener, we recognise this is complex and it's challenging. That the pandemic inevitably will remain the focus for as long as it needs to. But through the Scottish Government, local government, public bodies across Scotland, and indeed probably us as individuals, will get to the point that as we move into a transformation phase that sets out a clearer direction of what the future of spending patterns will be and what impact that has on public services. The committee will be familiar that Audit Scotland has been supporters of a clear transparency around the National Performance Framework, about that clearer connection between spending and outcomes for the delivery of public services. And we continue to make the case for that. We also recognise, though, that that it is challenging and there is conflict between spending. So if, you make the point about PPE and environmental concerns, and I suppose similarly you can make analogies between infrastructure, economy, environmental challenges, and how these spending patterns will come into conflict too. I think what we're keen to see is that as government and public bodies work through that, that there's a transparency around what spending is achieving and how that better connects to the national outcomes. And that's done on a regular and iterative basis. So there is just that regular transparency and people can know and can track what the impact of spending is achieving.
Okay, thanks. And just one final question from me before opening out to committee, and that's in terms of the committee's predecessor committee recommended that the incoming committee, i.e. ourselves, consider inviting the Scottish Fiscal Commission to publish a long-term fiscal sustainability report at least once during each session of the Parliament. When during the session do you think that would be most appropriate?
I'm happy to offer a view, actually. I'm sure Mark would too. I guess there's no right answer to that type of question. I think it's captured a broader suite of transparency is needed even when there is a great deal of volatility. As and when, you know, over the course of the next year, 18 months, if we're into a more stable environment. And I think I read, Convener, that as part of the Fiscal Commission's own thinking about into 2022, starting to consult into 2023, mm-hmm. for indicating that they're in will be in a clearer environment with which to publish, following consultation, a longer-term sustainability analysis of Scotland's public finances, you know, 10, 20, 30 years into the future. That would feel like an appropriate thing to do. I think our biggest point that we would make is that it's a necessary thing to do when the timing is right and when there's clarity best to do so. But that timescale feels about in the right timescale for us. But happy to see Mark viewing that too.
A couple of things to say. I think just to emphasise, strongly supportive of the proposal to do that, and really to get that sense of what the pressures on the public finances in the longer term are, and really see the value of that, and the pressures on sustainability, both in terms of the aggregate funding, but also how funding will need to be redirected through time, and some of the aspirations that are there in Christie and the like to respond to that. In terms of timing, I think the two reflections that I offer on that. One is, because of the nature of the task, which is to look ahead 30 years, 25 years ahead, it's helpful that it's almost divorced from the political cycle. I think the Fiscal Commission's proposals landed quite nicely in the middle of the parliamentary cycle. That would seem, if you forgive this phase, a safe space for that, where some of the immediate politics are set to one side, and it would feel to be a good time to do that and to look right through as to what the longer term perspective would be. So strongly supportive of the proposals, and the timing that's proposed would seem to be about right.
I don't know, even in 20 or 30 years, I'm sure Ross will still be with us. maybe one or two others as well. Okay, the first question from the committee is Liz, to be followed by Daniel.
Thank you. And may I stay on the issue about the transparency and the accountability, because I entirely agree with the convener that that really is the biggest job that faces this committee. And dare I say, I think it also is the biggest job facing the Parliament. You've been quite clear that both your predecessor, Caroline Gardner, and yourself are keen to see some additional processes that would enhance that transparency. You mentioned, I think, in your briefing just now about the summer revisions, and you mentioned also about the Public Accounts Commission could do that. Would you also recommend that there are structures in this Parliament that could be improved to enhance the scrutiny and accountability? For example, would it be, and I know you can't comment on policy at all, but would you ever consider that something like a finance bill, which this Parliament has not had as a customary procedure, would you consider that to be a possible way of improving transparency and accountability?
Thank you. Good morning. I'll certainly comment in detail on the first two points, and maybe a bit less on the notion of a finance bill, and Mark may wish to comment on all three. You're quite right that transparency and accountability were incredibly important pre-pandemic, and the need for such have been increased during the course of the scale of public spending, the volatility, addressing all the four arms and all those factors that we've talked about. We've said publicly that we welcomed the summer budget revision, given the volatility and the scale of additional spending, as an appropriate mechanism for which there could be additional scrutiny over new and significant forms of public spending that's taken place. Whether the Parliament and the Government choose to continue that is a matter for yourselves to decide upon, or whether it goes further, indeed, as some of that additional in-year opportunity, whether it's through this committee or elsewhere in the Parliament, for ongoing scrutiny of how public spending takes place. I would offer that there is regular scrutiny, as members would expect, in some of the individual public bodies themselves that are spending this money through their own governance structures, and there are chains of accountability through to the Parliament on a regular basis therein. On the point you mentioned about the Scottish public sector accounts, absolutely, Ms. Smith. We've been commenting regularly about the need for additional public financial reporting in Scotland. There is a UK-wide mechanism that the committee may be very familiar with, the whole of government accounts, that sets out all of the kind of range of what the UK public services own or spend and generate. But we don't have an equivalent version in Scotland. And given the scale of change that we've seen about the additional financial powers and responsibilities that the Scottish Parliament has acquired in recent years, we felt that is a missing component. The Scottish Government has publicly committed to it, and the Permanent Secretary has stated, and we would recognise that there have been plenty for the Government to be getting on with over the course of the past 18 months that has interrupted progress. But there's always plenty to get on with, and I think our sense is that there needs to be progress made in this so that we have a much clearer picture of what's spent. On the point about the finance bill, I'm probably less in a position to give a definitive view about the merits or demerits of that. I guess on a general point is that we are as an organisation, keen to support scrutiny, accountability, transparency, and we'd be happy to consider and give a more detailed view in writing about kind of where that might fit in. But Mark may wish to come in more detail on that point. Thank you.
Thanks, Officer General, and thanks for the question. I guess just to briefly run through on the consolidated, public consolidated accounts, just to build a little bit on the Auditor General's point, I think I'd make the link between that as additional information and the work that the Fiscal Commission may do in its longer term look at financial sustainability. It provides a different look at the future, because it takes into account essentially the public sector balance sheet as it currently stands and any pension liabilities, the asset base, and it gives a more rounded look at the current position as an eye to the future. The other thing I'd pull out in terms of additional information is around the increasing importance recently and will continue to be of in-year budget management. So a lot of the focus of scrutiny and of transparency has been around here the budget proposals. Increasingly, as those proposals change through the year and as actual spending diverges from what was planned in understandable circumstances, there's something for the committee and for the Parliament or generally to pay closer attention to those changes throughout the year and the nature and extent of scrutiny that you put both on the budget revision process and on the actual spending information that comes to you. I think as part of the spring budget revision, you should anticipate the most to-date update on the actual year-to-date position, and it's important to look at both of those and the information around both of those as an opportunity to develop that. On the question of the finance bill, I'd recognise some of the challenges here. So this isn't fully within the scope of this Parliament to be able to address, because you have a way in which the Scotland Act interacts with Public Finance and Accountability Act. I think one of the merits of a finance bill, it allows that picture in the round to be looked at, both on the spending and the revenue raising side in the round, but I recognise some of the technicalities that need to be worked through on that.
Could I just pick up the point you've just raised about spending in the round, trying to get an overview picture? Because I think one of the greatest challenges in politics today is to try to win the trust of the public about, especially the tax-paying public, as to where their money is being spent and who's accountable for that spending. And if anything goes wrong with it, you know, what are we as a parliament, as a committee, going to do about that? And I just wonder what your views are on the concern that some people have, members in this Parliament and perhaps some members of the public and some other bodies, that sometimes we make our judgments about scrutiny and public spending in relation to a specific committee, and as we are doing just now, on specific issues, rather than having the mechanism, certainly out with the budget process, to see the whole thing in the round. And that's why I was asking about a finance committee, a finance bill, obviously with the concerns about how that would articulate with the Scotland Act. But I just wonder if you have any views on whether there are any other procedures that are required to enhance the overview of Scotland's public finances, whether that comes down to better forecasting or whatever. I'm just interested in what you feel there.
Happy to start again. Mark wished to come in again. I think there are existing measures that are in place that support some of the scrutiny. So, not to repeat the previous point, but currently, the committee should be aware, there's an audit process around all of the spending that is allocated through the budget bill, and the funding that flows into the Scottish Government, to associated bodies, to local government, to NHS and so forth, is all subject to an annual audit. Much of that spending is then consolidated back into the Scottish Government's annual consolidated accounts. The outturn pre-audit is reported to the Parliament earlier this year, and then that's subject to an audit process and a completion of accounts. For a number of years, going back, I think if memory serves me correct, 7 or so years now consecutively, myself and Caroline Gardner have prepared a Section 22 report on the Scottish Government's consolidated accounts as a way of enhancing the accountability and public scrutiny of some of that spending that's taken place across public bodies, in particular those bodies that have fed into the Scottish Government's consolidated accounts process. Unfortunately, there's a complexity about which bodies are in and which are out, known as the accounting boundary. that means that there are still some significant lines of public spending that aren't captured within, and some very high profile examples of money that's gone outside of the Scottish Government to other organisations and so forth that have been subject to our commentary, and examples being our call for a greater set of a framework for investing in private companies as a mechanism to support additional accountability and scrutiny. So again, Ms. Smith, I would point to and welcome any additional measures that allow for a more rounded set of scrutiny and audit arrangements across public spending. So we, as the Scottish Public Sector Accounts, would be one example. And then I think, as Mark has mentioned, whether over and above that, mechanisms that the Parliament and this committee may wish to explore that would further enhance the existing setup.
Can I just one more question, convener, if I may? Can I just pick up on the point about this additional scrutiny? Last week, I think it was the convener who was asking the Deputy First Minister about how easy it is to drill down when it comes to a national performance framework. How easy is it to drill down on something that is a national spend and something that is a local government spend? And that's very difficult because it's not easy to see where the money is being spent and who's accountable for it. Do you have any recommendations about how we could improve on that process of actually understanding where the budget lines are for local government as opposed to national spend?
Yeah, I'm happy to start, and again, Mark will want to come in on this point, I'm sure. It's not a new theme for Audit Scotland. We've produced a report, I think it was in 2018, on planning for outcomes that, again, call for a much clearer connection between what's spent and what outcomes, what's been achieved from that public spending. And there have been examples of progress across the piece, but especially the point you make about who's accountable for those different lines, where those lines come into conflict between different public bodies. And the risk of repeating myself is it is complex, but there are not enough examples, even like kind of looking outside Scotland across the world, about where this is done terribly well. But there ought to be ways that we can do so. So following through on the recommendations that we made in our report, and then tracking through where the spend, who's the most direct organisation responsible for individual lines of public spending, and then having the accountability that's fed back through into the public reporting through the medium-term financial strategy, through the public sector accounts, Scottish Government accounts, and then the National Performance Framework Outcome Report, all feel like appropriate ways that we can best do so. But there's no doubt there's progress to be made on that front. Mark, Anthony, question.
Thank you. I think I'd start by recognising that the Parliament has a relatively new budget process, budget scrutiny process, and at the heart of that scrutiny process was to deal with questions like this. And I think the turbulent period that we've been through since then has thrown some challenges in the Parliament's way around how to apply that scrutiny process, but the core of that still holds and works well and enables individual subject committees and finance committee to take on different aspects of the budget in the round. And at its heart is to provide opportunity for committees to look at where's money going, what's it achieving, what's working, what's not working well, both on a kind of subject committee by subject committee basis, and local government has the opportunity to explore local government spend in that, and also to look at how the information is made available to indicate, well, when this spending initiative is coming in or when this new strategy is coming in, this is what we expect to happen in terms of the impact on outcomes, both in local government and in central government. And here's the reporting back from government, from public bodies, about how well is that happening. And the budget process was premised on better articulation of those two things, where public money is going, what we're getting for our money. And I think there's opportunities right across the Parliament to focus scrutiny on that, not on a line-by-line basis, but in an overall sense, and to pick out some particular areas. I think the challenge for this particular committee and the Parliament as a whole is how the cross-cutting decisions are made around that. I think that is one of the advantages of the finance bill, is that it will give an opportunity for a focus on that. And I guess one of the things for the committee to consider is how much it is able to and wishes to get into that sense of, well, if we pull back from subject committee to subject committee, all of which will generally say we think we need more money for our area, I think we could all recognise that, into what some of the trade-offs in there are. I think with the Deputy First Minister's role to have that cross-cutting look. I think there's a real opportunity for this committee to engage on that question, engage on, well, how do you as government do that, and what evidence are you able to provide us about the decisions that you've made on that? Very lastly, and in reference to an earlier question, there's something here about clarity of priorities from government. That question, I think you asked, Convener, about how do you balance the here and now of COVID with the longer-term aims? I think that's a priorities and transparency question. How is government doing that, and how is it directing the money to support that? I think the budget process, as it's currently designed, helps support that activity.
Thank you very much. To very helpful.
Thank you. Daniel, to be followed by Ross.
I want to ask about transparency, but before I do, and I guess this is transparency as well, I mean, I think I'll hold my hands up. I mean, I have been struggling to keep up with precisely kind of what has come through in terms of the COVID money and what has been allocated and what has not. And can I just say that Exhibit 4 in your report, I think, is extremely useful. But just to clarify what this is saying, so £4.9 billion in the current financial year has been allocated by the UK government, the Scottish government, but essentially everything that has come through in consequentials since March, is my understanding is that has yet to be allocated. Is that by the Scottish government? Is that a correct summary? Or I just appreciate your kind of view on what has been allocated and what hasn't of that, actually of the overall 4.9.
Thanks for the question. I think Mark's just going to take us through the exhibit and to explain our assessment of it.
Thank you, Auditor General. I think the first thing to recognise is that the autumn budget revision was published yesterday. So the answer to that question today is different from the answer to that question on Friday. What the exhibit shows is that, and this is to do with the nature of the budget process being episodic. So a number of occasions through the year, traditionally twice, but last year there was a third summer budget revision, the government balances the books, if you like, in terms of a budget process. But in advance of that, the government has an understanding of, to different degrees of certainty, what money is expected to flow through and where that money comes from in terms of UK decisions. What the exhibit shows is that at the time that we pulled this report together, that at that point, the government was aware of up to £5 billion worth of funding in year, but had through a formal budget process, allocated a cumulative amount of £3.7 billion. Yesterday's announcement added effectively another billion onto that, so 4.7 out of the five. And the autumn budget revision document explains that effectively £300 million is both either yet to be allocated from reserves and UK government funding. What that does is to give government a degree of flexibility over how it applies that, but also there is a recognition that the formal budget process is always, if you like, lagging behind government decisions about where the money's going to go. And in a very fast-moving environment that we've had, that has been much more apparent than it would normally be. It's the sense of almost that speed dropping off a little bit and therefore getting a bit closer, particularly with yesterday's announcement, to that end position. So you've got two things going on. One is a bit of a lag before information is formalised in the budget process, plus a degree of contingency management and flexibility that we would recognise as important to allow the government to respond. So an update up to the 4.7 yesterday.
Yeah. That's really helpful. And I think, moreover, I mean, I think I recognise that the point you're saying is that quite often, even when those are allocated, they may be labelled, but that doesn't necessarily mean that you know precisely where the cheques are going. You're both nodding at that. I'd like to move on a little bit about why there's an issue with transparency. And again, looking at paragraph 41 and the bullet points, that rang some alarm bells for me. Because, just to quote, the existing processes for monitoring the budget were not designed to separate out specific spending in areas across portfolios. And then in specifically under the reallocations point, bullet point, saying it's not always possible to establish the detail of reprioritisations within directories. Now, could you just explain what you're saying to me? Because on my reading of that, one of two things is happening. Either the Scottish Government has that information and it's not sharing it and reporting on it, which would be troubling, but or it's not tracking effectively that information at a subdirectorate level, which is not just worrying, it's downright dangerous. For an organisation of, you know, £40 billion, I would be expecting them to be tracking their spend at organisational units well below directorates. So which of those is it? And are you comfortable that they are tracking their spend at an effective level as an organisation?
I'm happy to start on that, Mr Johnson, and Marco, I'm sure I want to come in as well. I think in totality, our view is that they are tracking the spend, and whether or not, if I step back for a second, I'd say that all the things we've talked about the volatility, recognising that, but the need for additional transparency that goes around it. And we mentioned in the report elsewhere about some of the judgments that government has had to make in terms of the officials of migrating spending announcements, the flow through of Barnett consequentials, and how that then is allocated to individual budget lines and directorates. It's undoubtedly complicated. But nonetheless, I think the need for a clear and consistent mechanism with which to support reporting, aside that is one of our kind of key asks that comes through in this process, whether that's through additional budget processes within government, reporting to the Parliament alongside the summer budget process, all feels like it's a necessary component of taking this forward. We would say that the reprovisioning arrangements too are also to be looked at. Are they working? I think a lot of the kind of processes that the government have brought in and deployed to track from the spending announcements into individual budget lines have been done at great pace. And we've commented previously that the fiscal arrangements within the fiscal framework weren't designed for the kind of mechanisms that we find ourselves dealing with. What transpires and what comes will be a matter for both governments and parliaments to determine. But nonetheless, we think there's a greater mechanism that can be set about to improve the transparency that we currently see. But Mark, you want to comment on the 2 points? Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. I think I'd start just by recognising that the focus of our work to date has been on the numbers and understanding what's happening. We've also got a more detailed piece of work up and running, which will run over the next few months and look to report in spring on exactly this sort of question about how the detail of the management happened, recognising, as Auditor General says, the circumstances in which that took place and how things developed through time. So in time, we'll have more in-depth understanding and greater evidence base to be able to get into the detail of this. At a broad level and based on our understanding at the moment, what's happening here is that it's the ability of government quickly to aggregate up information that it holds is the real challenge. And what government is doing is almost, having not designed the systems to do this first pass, is going back to look at a very detailed level to identify what the spend was on. As we look into the current financial year, they've built more systems to enable them to do that on a more routine basis and would make that more straightforward, but it's quite a manual process to go back through. That's not to say it's not been managed, because it's been managed at a more detailed level within directorates, within individual spending areas. The last thing to say is there is a protocol between government and this committee and the Parliament generally about what gets brought to the budget in terms of amounts and what is able to be managed at these lower levels. And as far as we can see, the government's been working within those levels. But there's been a lot more of that detailed in department management that's had to happen through time. And we'll look to work with government and try and get more of an understanding of both how that's worked and some of the detail that sits behind that through time. But the information we share today is our best estimates for what the impact has been.
That's really helpful. And I'd love to go down the rabbit hole of how the Scottish Government manages its cost centres, but I'll save that for another day. I'd just like to sort of maybe explore kind of what greater transparency looks like. And again, if I'm sort of taking kind of comparable sized organisations, they would typically report on a quarterly basis, and they would typically be reporting both how their revenue and their costs have tracked against what they'd stated previously in an annual statement. And indeed, in America, the SEC requires 3 such quarterly updates alongside their annual report. That used to be the case in this country until 2014. Do you think that would be a reasonable thing to ask of government, to provide a regular, pre-scheduled quarterly updates on the budget? And critically, I'm guessing this is what you were implying by some of your previous comments, that's both how budgets are revised, but also tracking spend against budget. Because I think sometimes in this place we have a habit of focusing almost entirely on the budget and a lot less on actually how the money is being spent against budget. Is that quarterly concept something that could be applied to government?
It's a reasonable starting point. That the scale and complexity of spending that goes through the Scottish government accounts and through the Scottish budget, there wouldn't be many comparable examples in private sector of organisations of that size that would have that level of turnover. The scale and how that translates to in-year budget management, I think as we touched on in passing this morning, is that the Scottish Government, like all organisations, has its own in-year budget management process, its own in-year reporting that it does to its executive team, government ministers and so forth. We'll have insight as to kind of progress against the budget lines. As that then translates into the Parliament, clearly we've typically had the autumn budget revision, spring budget revision, and more recently the summer budget revision. So adding another quarterly reporting into that mix to satisfy the scale of change and volatility and support transparency is a very reasonable suggestion. Whether that's one that is achievable in practice would clearly require additional investment to get to that point. But it's not something that we would say is beyond the realms of possibility. And the point you make, Mr. Johnson, about the shift away from focusing on the budget, I think for us, we're keen, as you would expect, as auditors. Part of our role is, as well as the backward look, is also the forward. But in terms of that backward position, reporting on the outturn, reporting on the consolidated accounts through Parliament, then our Section 22 reporting to the Public Audit Committee are all part of the components. But specifically the point you request about, could one additional cycle be brought into to support transparency, if that was felt to be an appropriate mechanism, then one we could see happening, yeah.
Thank you very much. And can I also thank you for saying that I made a reasonable suggestion. I think that might be a first in this place. Just one final question. And again, I think the committee is broadly in the same place that you are about kind of the importance of the National Performance Framework. But I think the need to sort of make sure that it is properly embedded. And again, one of the thoughts that was explored last week with the Deputy First Minister is whether actually it should be reported on formally, either in at the same time as the budget, or certainly that there should be a regular reporting. And I was also wondering, in a sense, I understand the points you're making about the need for these things to be reported across government, but we very rarely hear Cabinet Secretaries report on how their bit of the National Performance Framework is progressing. I mean, do you think regular reporting of it, and indeed by portfolio, might actually help give this sort of due weight and prioritisation and change the behaviours regarding how the National Performance Framework is used?
We've been, as I mentioned, commenting for a number of years about the importance of the National Performance Framework. There's a much clearer connection between what money's been spent and what's been achieved from that spending. My one note of caution around it is that the measures, and we tried to convey some of this sentiment in some of our recent reporting, recognising the 10-year anniversary of the Christie Commission report, that the measures drive a lot of the behaviours. So there's a real need to think about, are the measures the right one to produce the outcomes? And particularly the convener's earlier point is that some of these measures will be in conflict with one another in terms of what's intended to be achieved. And we see that across public bodies, is that public bodies in many ways will perform to the measures, even if that and the budget and accountability that goes alongside that. And that may not necessarily produce the right outcome for the people who are using and relying upon public services. So whilst we're absolutely supportive of there being a much clearer connection between spending and outcomes in national performance framework reporting, no doubt, I think we're just slightly cautious or indeed enthusiastic that there's an assessment of the measures that are being used to determine how well public spending is being made.
Okay, Ross, to follow by John.
Thanks, Convener. Returning to Daniel Johnson's initial line of questioning, I'm still trying to understand the relationship between the underspend of COVID-specific funds in 2020-21 and the reallocation of non-COVID budgets towards COVID-related purposes in that year. So you've identified it in the report. There's this £700 million gap between the amount of money allocated for COVID-related purposes specifically and the identified spend in that area. But there's simultaneously more than £1 billion that was reallocated from non-COVID budgets into COVID-specific purposes. How much of that £700 million was spent but hasn't yet been identified as COVID spend for the reasons that you noted earlier? And how much of it was simply not spent in that year because presumably it came too late and other money had already been allocated to meet that need?
Good morning. I'm happy to kick off and invite Mark to come in a minute. I think on a high level, we've looked to set out in the tracker, really, and as Mark mentioned, it's kind of our best estimate, subject to some of the numbers to be audited before we're able to be definitive on what was spent and what was reallocated. It's noting both the complexity and the volume of changes that took place, some of these happening quite late in the year. In terms of the allocations at a high level, in addition to the Scottish Government's commitment that it would use Barnett consequentials to fund COVID-related expenditure, it also reallocated spending from some of its existing budgets. And what we've generally seen is those tended to follow a portfolio-related activity. So I think one of the examples we refer to in the report is that subsidies for travel arrangements were allocated towards travel operators to support their costs. And that similar point about just some of the monies coming very late in the year also added to that complexity. But I'll pause for a moment and see if Mark was just to kind of address the specifics of the numbers you asked about, Mr. Greer.
I think the short answer to your question is we don't know yet. I think that is the fundamental thing, and the work that government's doing to uncover, to identify the spending at a lower level will help us and government to identify that. And I think, as I said at the outset, there's an importance to that given political commitments that have been made about the use of that funding. In terms of the overall picture, there's a number of moving parts here about the additional redeployment of money from other spending areas to COVID areas, from the Barnett consequentials that are coming through, and also from the use of the reserve, both to draw from money and to carry forward money to future years. I think the rounded picture set out in the outturn statement about where that lands, and then when you look in detail at the autumn budget revision that was published yesterday, you could then see how that money then is then reallocated, if you like, in the current year as it flows through from the reserve. So a lot of moving parts in there, but the short version is that at this stage we can't answer that question, and there's therefore more important in the work that government's doing to identify all of its COVID spend.
What's the timescale, or what expectation have you been given from government on the timescale for that work to get the more granular information that's required?
So just short answer to that. So we don't have a firm timescale for that. I think my expectation is, as the government moves towards the next budget round and the autumn budget revision, that we'd look to pull that together. I think we'll never. I think we're unlikely to get to a definitive position. I think there'll be kind of diminishing returns setting. I think when we look at 2021 as opposed to 21-22, I think there's a degree of realism that we have about how difficult that is given the environment which with decisions were made, particularly at the start of the pandemic.
The only point I would add, and Mark referenced this earlier, is that we have work underway as part of our Following the Pandemic Pound programme of audit activity, and look to report in the spring of next year about how well some of the money that has been spent through the COVID process. both across central government and local government, so a joint piece of work myself and the Accounts Commission, to try and give a sense of moving beyond just what's been spent, but getting some of that territory of the outcomes, the value for money, the scale of spending that's taken place.
Probably book you in for an appointment in spring now to talk about that. You mentioned some of the money on transport, which I think is a useful example for one of the other issues that I was going to raise around the explanation provided by government for underspend. So your report mentions that the explanation given for some of the underspend on money for buses, for example, and that some operators simply moved back to a place of viability quicker than was expected. Now, there's not any explanation mentioned in your report for the underspend on rail. Is that simply because this is a relatively high-level report and you were just looking to provide some commentary, or are there areas where you have not yet been given a sufficient explanation from government for why those underspends took place?
So it's the former rather than the latter. But again, Mark may wish to come in a moment. I think it is a high-level report. It's part of a series of trackers as part of our wider role, as well as auditing the council's contribution to inform just with the scale of spending that's taken place. So we haven't sought to, in this report, to set out all the reasons for under and overspends. But just to give kind of broader examples, I think in addition to the work that we do, there's a very clear role for government in terms of transparency about why there are over and underspends. Some of that will come through the consolidated accounts, which are usually include narrative against individual spending lines where there's been an underspend. Apologies, Mr. Graham, I think it's of where there's a variance of 5 million. There's usually accompanied by an explanation, but it's a range of, as well as through our own report, there'll be a space for government to set out. Again, Mark may wish to just say about the conversations we've had with government.
Yeah, this example we've used in the report to illustrate the challenge here, I guess. And the challenge for government is that quickly it's had to make announcements on spend. It's had to assess the likely demand for that spend, assess the forward affordability for that spend, and we'll make an announcement and start getting money out the door to people who need it. As it then experiences, well, how much demand is there for that particular area of funding, and to what extent has that sector or industry recovered or is able to meet the requirements, then it will refine its estimate. And so what you're seeing is that refinement process. I think critically, where that's happened, one of the things we're looking to investigate in more detail in the audit work that's coming is the job of government is then to understand where money is freeing up and make the best decisions about where to redeploy it. And you'll see from Exhibit 2 around the first and second tranche of business support measures as an example of that, where the initial estimate was above what was required, but then the underspend, if we want to use that phrase, was then recycled into the next set of announcements. And there's real value in that way of working. I guess the difficulty of that is that when you add those numbers up, it looks like there's an underspend, and what we're trying to explain in the report here is the dynamic nature and way in which that budget's managed through time.
Point that underspend is probably not the most useful phrase for us to use, and particularly the business allocation is probably the best example of that, and that it was spent, and it was spent quite well, just not in exactly the same way. Just one final, potentially quite daft question. You mentioned some of the reallocations. So, for example, money that had initially been allocated for passenger subsidies in relation to buses was moved over towards supporting the operators directly. I take it that is still, in terms of the budget lines that are listed here for spend on buses, that's the same money appearing in the same place. It doesn't create the appearance of an underspend in one area because that money is then being allocated as spend in another.
I think on that example, that is the case, but I think there are other examples where it becomes more complicated and harder to track if there's been a reallocation of a budget that's perhaps not Barnett consequential related, but in an existing budget, not required for whichever drop in demand or spending circumstances. If that's then moved to another budget line, that becomes harder. So I'm pretty clear that there'll be examples of both of those things through the budget process.
Thanks. That's all from me, Convener.
No bother. John, to be followed by Douglas.
Thanks very much, Convener. To continue the theme of tracking COVID expenditure, which most of my predecessors have raised, I mean, I just wonder, A, is it possible, and B, is it helpful or necessary? I mean, So I was trying to think of an example, and the example I came up with was if somebody's operation was postponed, hip replacement or something like that, and because of COVID, they then need more painkillers while they're waiting for their operation. They have to see a nurse, they have to see a GP, perhaps. So where does the cost of the painkillers, the nurse and the GP, where does that go? They're, in one sense, they're there anyway. That's not directly related to COVID, but you could say, well, it's because of COVID all of these costs have come along. So, and that, there's never a right answer to that. I can see the arguments on both sides. That's got to be a judgment, surely. So can you comment on that?
Yeah, delighted to. Good morning. I guess how the government have sought to frame the four harms of COVID. So you'll have the direct health implications of the pandemic seen through NHS spend and NHS budget lines. Some of those, kind of indirect health will also be captured in health spending. But again, it gets much harder to track, you know, through the societal implications and economic. So there'll be direct budget lines that we've seen, so whether it's support for businesses, additional funding for local authorities, whether it's through some of the societal aspects to support education that we've commented on. But undoubtedly, the point you make about it becomes one of judgment and trying to frame what is and what isn't COVID-related. The complexity of doing so probably becomes quite overwhelming, actually, as you get not too far into it. What we'd say, if we were able to step back slightly, is that whilst we're in the pandemic and still in a very clear spending phase of the pandemic, there's a necessity, just for the sheer impact that it's had on Scotland's public finances, that we do our best, that the Parliament is as clear as it can be about what is COVID-related and what isn't COVID-related. But I think the very clear point you make, Mr. Mason, is that the further we go out and as some of that direct spending in the pandemic ebbs, that's going to become much harder to do so in the longer term.
And does that matter? Should we be worried about that, or do we just have to accept that, really?
I think it matters that for as long as we're able to do so with a clear mechanism that we deploy it, probably what comes next will be of, you know, of equal interest, that through the, you know, the recovery, the renewal phase, any transformation, that then also is supported by clear mechanisms, appropriate transparency of how public spending is being undertaken. And I think it goes back to the earlier line of questioning about what's been achieved from that public spending, you know, as what are the outcomes associated with it, and whether that's through the direct lines on a medium-term financial plan or the budget, that these are the intended outcomes from the spending, and that there's then a process, transparency and accountability that can track what was actually achieved from it.
As long as we understand how the decision was made, even though the decision could have gone either way, okay, that's helpful. I mean, you made the point, I think it was in the report somewhere, that I think it was 300 different announcements related to COVID. I mean, is there an implied criticism there that there were too many announcements, too many funds, the whole thing was too complex, we're doing better with just two funds, you know, one for business, one for the health service, and got on with it?
It's not intended as a criticism. I think it's a factual comment that we look to make in this report, and I think probably captures what, you know, we tried to do through the series of trackers, is that these are more information piece as opposed to judgment-led from us. On the scale of the announcements, again, just the across the range of initiatives addressing the four harms and where money needed to be spent at great pace, and that probably captured just, you know, the circumstances that we're in. Probably it's followed the pattern that we would have expected at this stage of the evolution of the pandemic, that in last year, I think we got to 230 spending announcements in the 2021 financial year. We are, I don't have the up-to-date figure, but the end of July that we quote in the report, we were at 70. So we can probably see a reduction in the scale of spending. What that means in future is for, you know, will be to be determined. The point that we would make in the report is it's harder, it's more complex when there is such a scale of additional spending announcements. And as we move to a more steady state through recovery and renewal, we probably expect that to be far less than we've seen.
I mean, sometimes in relation to tax, for example, you know, it gets more complicated because we're trying to make it fairer. And if you make it simple, it's not so fair. Would that be a kind of dichotomy that you would agree with?
It's an interesting analogy, actually, that the simplicity of a system has benefits, but, you know, it can rub up against fairness or transparency even as well. So I think it's a trade-off, and probably for, you know, as we move into that steady state of renewal, recovery and future budgets. And again, I wouldn't understate that it is complicated, and particularly that point about translating what public spending is achieving from outcomes, and that some of those outcomes may be in conflict, is a challenging thing to do, but nonetheless important that clarity and transparency is there.
Yeah, I mean, I think we have spent time before and we'll spend more time in the future, but I'll leave the one about the links with the national outcomes at the moment. One of your other suggestions, I think it's point 26 in the report, talks about future updates should include better information about planned spending options and how these could affect outcomes. And I just wondered what really was meant by that. I mean, local government in its budgeting quite often has options. So they'll say things like, well, if we close all the libraries, that'll save us £1 million. And then the public all gets excited and reacts, and then they kind of save the libraries, and that's good news. That's not been the way we've tended to do it at the Scottish Parliament, Scottish Government budgeting. So is it that kind of thing, throwing out options that people would then comment on, or is it something else that was meant?
I think that's an interesting example. I'm not sure it's the one that we'd necessarily intended, albeit we recognise that the type of spending and revenue-generating decisions that local authorities will make, whether it relates to libraries or the setting of the council tax and so forth, is a mechanism. Whether the Parliament would similarly wish to deploy that through their income tax-raising powers and spending-related approaches is one of those options. But in addition to that, I think we're kind of a bit more neutral about some of the options that the Parliament might wish to deploy. But I'll just turn to Mark, see if there's anything he wishes to add.
Yeah, thank you, Auditor General. The root of the point is really around, I think, medium-term financial strategy. And historically, where there's been cases where government has known that there has been a budget adjustment mechanism reconciliation coming, and previously in the medium-term financial strategy, there was no options or no indication of how government was looking to meet the impact of that. Indeed, it could go the other way, and government might look to say, well, actually, we've got a windfall essentially coming, and how can we use that? And we think that when government spells out its medium-term financial strategy, as well as looking at the core kind of midpoint expectation, there's something about these things are coming, and this is the sort of thing that we need to deal with, and this is the range of demands that's placing on the public finances, and therefore the options that we've got to deal with it are reduce expenditure, increase revenue, etc. And so I think in the context of that medium-term financial strategy is a bit more of a sense of how government is thinking that it will address some of the challenges that are inherent in the next few years.
So it would really, the ball would start to be in the government's court, that they would come forward with three or four options in a particular area, and then we, as committees in Parliament, would perhaps discuss that, and the public would as well. Is that the kind of?
So I think there's an opportunity for that. I think what we've called for essentially is that at least one is set out. I think recognising the challenge and recognising what the anticipated response to that is, and where there is ambiguity about what that response might be, then perhaps a range of options would be an opportunity for a bit of discussion about that. I think our point that we've made and reported on previously is that budget pressure has not been responded to in the material that's been set out.
Okay, thanks. And in that same kind of sector of the report, talking about transition from response to recovery, paragraph 28, it talks about government will need to have a clear understanding of how it plans to transition, and yet two lines further down, it is also likely to need to maintain a flexible approach. I mean, it strikes me that these two are somewhat balance against each other. Is it possible to get the balance in there?
I think time will tell if it's possible together. I'm not sure we're in a position to give that level of certainty at the moment, recognising the volatility that we're in. And I think it's, I guess the point we're making about the clarity around the priorities, we've all seen through the course of the pandemic and recent reporting that Scotland's public finances were dealing with many priorities before the pandemic. Some of those have been exacerbated following the impact of the pandemic. We've talked in some of our reporting about the challenges of within the NHS and our justice systems and recovering to levels of service and throughput that the public will want. Some of the harms of the pandemic and inequalities that have been exacerbated. So all of these things are true, but there is that conversation and transparency about how these priorities will be set and how they'll be funded and what will be achieved from them.
And I think my final question, it was to follow up something that Mr. Taylor, you said to Liz Smith about, you know, more looking at changes during the year. And I mean, I get Ross Greer's point on whoever said it, that maybe we should have, you know, four reviews or there should be fixed times. But I was just wondering if you could unpack that a little bit more. I mean, if, say, you know, we get a bit of extra money from Barnet, from Westminster, and the government announces we're going to put it into childcare or something like that. I mean, are you thinking that the committee, that committee, be it education or local government or something, would then do a bit more work on that kind of announcement? Is that how a committee should be, or you would suggest a committee might examine that more than they've been doing in the past?
I guess where I'd start on this is, I think that, and absolutely I'm supportive of the shift from reporting on plans to reporting on what's actually been spent. So I think that's an important shift. Having said that, I think there's an opportunity for this committee, through its work around budget amendments, to look in more detail about the specifics of that. I think if we look at the most recently published budget amendment, so about £1 billion has been added in yesterday's announcement, alongside the underlying budget position. There's an opportunity for this committee and its scrutiny of that audit budget revision to investigate where that money's planned to go and how it fits with the sort of issues that we've been talking about earlier about that sense of who needs the money and what difference has it been made. So I'd start there as an opportunity to build on the approach that you've got as a committee already and to get into that more generally. I think it is an interesting question at the extent to which that work is shared around and that there might be an investigation and inquiries around some of the big spending platforms that are part of the COVID response across committees. And I think there's opportunities for committees to do that as part of their pre-budget scrutiny. Local government was mentioned earlier, and that's an obvious example where that might happen. I think the root of my comment was around the opportunity for this committee to look at the dynamic nature of budgeting through the year. We've been through 2 years where what the actual spend at the end of the year bears very little, it looks very different from what was planned at the budget at the start. But if you look at the balance of where scrutiny happened, you know, 95% of it, probably more, was on that initial position. It's an opportunity to broaden out that look as to what's happening through the year, both in terms of changed plans and also what's the actual spend that's coming through.
Mm-hmm. It's quite an interesting thought. Maybe it's up for the committee to look at that in the future. If, say, the government announces more for health, you know, who would then challenge the government and say, no, don't spend so much on health, let's spend more on education? I don't know if that's the role of this committee or who would do that. Anyway, I'll leave it at that. Thanks so much.
I think we're all taking the fifth on that one, John. Douglas, and followed by Michelle.
Thanks, Convener. When Liz was asking earlier about transparency and external organisations, I think you said that some were under the Scottish Government umbrella in terms of audit and some weren't. As a new member, could you maybe just explain a little bit more on that?
I'm only happy to do so. So the maybe start from the high level. The Scottish budget sets out what the Parliament approves will be spent, and much of that flows to Scottish public bodies, Scottish Government itself, NHS, local government. All of those bodies and public sector in Scotland will prepare their own accounts. They'll all be subject to audit. Public reporting goes alongside that. Some of those bodies' accounts are then brought back into what's called the Scottish Government Consolidated Accounts, and there's an accounting boundary, apologies for the technical description, that And that is determined by a combination of Scottish Government and financial reporting guidelines that give an indication of which bodies are in that. The reason it's probably come into sharper focus in recent years is that there are some bodies who just aren't part of that accounting boundary, and they're quite high profile in the work that they've done, their use of public money in recent times. It really kind of stems, therefore, we don't think that's a strong enough position to be. You don't think it supports accountability for how well public money's been spent. And that led us really to a number of years ago and the point that we've made repeatedly in recent times of why we think there's a missing component, why the Scottish public sector accounts feels like a necessary thing to do to set out all of the scale of assets, liabilities, what Scotland generates and what it spends.
I guess that would also include bodies that were given money to allocate for COVID funding. Just as an example, I'm thinking Creative Scotland, you know, who I think they had a culture organisation and venues recovery fund where they can allocate between 10,000 and $250,000. And, you know, there's a list of, you know, which organisations received funding, but I can't see any basis of how it was allocated. Would that be one organisation, for example, that maybe more transparency, you know, could be given to the public?
You're right. You say there's a range of public bodies that have been responsible for spending COVID-related monies, and there's two components to it. One where they've spent the money themselves, and the other where they've been more of an agency style of function, where they've been allocating the spend to onward recipients. A lot of the business grants have been in that space. I don't think there's an accountability gap necessarily around that organisation, in that they will be preparing their annual report and accounts. It will be subject to audit and scrutiny that will set out really quite clear detail what money they spent and importantly what was achieved from it. So and again, I think we mentioned it already this morning, to supplement that, we have a programme of work following the pandemic pound. It doesn't just cover central government bodies, it is going to bring into the enterprise agencies, Creative Scotland, local government bodies, just about how well that money's been spent. They're really building on the tracker papers that we've been producing, and that's something that we'll be publishing into the spring of next year.
To answer my next question, which was around the following the pandemic pound, but organisations like that will be part of that work.
Yeah, so it's a broad suite of work, and again, I'll pass to Mark in a moment. He's leading that on behalf of Audit Scotland. There's a lot of organisations involved, and I think it affords us the opportunity with the public audit setup that we have in Scotland that can bring in organisations in central government that I'm responsible for auditing, and then those for the Accounts Commission in local government. This is a really good example of that just because of the scale and all public spending of COVID monies, that it's really across the panoply of public bodies that we can do that. It involves central government, NHS and local government bodies, but Mark can say a bit more about where we're going with that.
Yeah, thank you, Auditor General. I think our overall approach is initially to look at where the money's gone, how it's been used and whose pocket has it ended up in ultimately, and what the decision making and accountability arrangements are around all of that, which will deal with some of your questions there. I think through time, increasingly, as Auditor General suggests, we'll make the shift to and how well did that work then type questions and the evaluation of the spend. But inevitably and necessarily that will take some time to be able to get to that stage, given the nature of the pandemic and how governments work through that. In relation to a body like Creative Scotland, I guess the question for us is the degree of granularity to look at individual bodies alongside the overall picture. So we set out to look at overall picture. We've picked a number of bodies in an initial piece of work who have been the largest recipients of funding, to look at how those sort of arrangements have worked in those bodies, and we'll report on that. I think as time goes on, then we'll, on a risk basis, look to try and think about what other, how do we drill down into some of the detail, alongside, as the Auditor General suggests, the reporting that we will already do on Creative Scotland and the Auditor will do on Creative Scotland around its own arrangements. So a longer term period of a programme of work underway, and you would expect reporting over the next months and years as we get into the detail of that.
So when will we start seeing the follow the pandemic pound reports coming back to us?
So a very quick answer to that is one of the first ones you're looking at today. On the specifics, the broader look at how this has been managed and a bit more of the judgments that Auditor General was talking about, we've scheduled that for spring and would expect to take that initial broad view of how how pandemic spending has been managed and begin to exercise some judgments on the management of that in the spring next year.
Next question was around in 23. You talk about the Scottish Government has committed to producing a consolidated account to cover the whole public sector in Scotland, including assets, investment, liabilities, and things. And you know, that's recently been highlighted to that there's a need more than ever for that. I'm just trying to think, when was that commitment made? Do we have any idea when it's going to be coming, and why is it so important?
Taylor, it's a number of years since there's been a formal commitment from government to produce it, and there have been progress behind the scenes in terms of iterations about kind of, the point we made about the accounting boundary, the fact that there are complexities in different style of financial reporting of public bodies in Scotland. So the way that local government sets out accounts is really quite different from that of the NHS and central government. So absolutely recognise that this isn't a straightforward process. But I think our sense is that progress hasn't been what it ought to have been, recognising the significance of this component of financial reporting in Scotland. We were pleased to hear the Permanent Secretary reaffirm the Scottish Government's commitment to it and the progress that they intend to make at the previous Public Audit Committee at the beginning of this year. But that pandemic activity response had slowed progress. We are again calling for the need for this component of Scottish financial reporting to be completed as soon as possible. And we'll, through our own reporting on the Scottish Government later this year, we'll report how well that is going. But it's a necessary thing to happen, Mr. Lumsden, and we hope to see progress soon.
And just back to why do you feel it's so important to have that information?
I think what we don't have is a single reference point at the moment that sets out all of Scottish public assets and liabilities, revenue that's generated, and what's being spent. So we have various different documents to set out aspects of that, but no single source. So, for example, we have public sector pensions and Scotland's road assets, both a significant liability and a significant asset. They're not in the same document at the moment, but we know that they exist. So for ease of public scrutiny, public understanding, the Parliament's awareness, ownership of it, we think this is a really important thing to take forward.
Thank you. And final question was around, you know, points 5 and 7. 5, you talk about the disruptions to education and you know, more. It says most likely that those who are already economically and educationally disadvantaged, you know, the pandemic will affect more. And 7 as well talks about increasing inequality. And I guess listening to that, but also listening to, you know, there's, I think it was mentioned, 300 million of that's uncommitted so far. So I guess, you know, this is so important, as I think we all think it is. There's money there to be spent quickly if the government chooses to do so. Would that be right?
I'll ask Mark to come in about the 300 million and the extent to which that's uncommitted and available, as you say. In terms of the disruption points in education, myself and the Accounts Commission reported earlier this year and gave evidence to the Public Audit Committee on the Education Outcomes Report and the impact that COVID has had on Scotland's children and young people. So recognising that point, we also done in our previous suite of following the pandemic pound reporting, also touched on aspects of inequality that's been exacerbated by the pandemic. In our NHS report, we mentioned some of groups in society that have been more adversely impacted by the direct health implications of COVID too. So all of these factors, I think, bring us back to, through this report, about the priorities that government, parliament wish to set for public spending, that's clear and money is used as quickly as possible. But on the 300 million, I'll just ask Mark to come in on that point. Thank you.
Thanks, Auditor General. I guess this is an example of what John Mason and the convener were asking us about, that tension between flexibility and plans. And I think that uncommitted amount is the concrete example of that. And I guess a job for the committee is to understand the extent to which there are plans up government sleeve, or whether that's a rainy day fund, or whether in between those two. But I think that recognition that the flip side of committing all available funds and all the funds that you expect is that you minimise the flexibility you have equally by holding a contingency, by having a degree of flexibility that allows you to deploy money later in the year in response to events. Obviously, you take the judgment, take the policy decision that you're trading off against that as to some of the spending that you can identify now. I guess that's the stuff of government and the stuff of politics, and absolutely the stuff of scrutiny for this committee.
Yes, it's all about urgency and priorities. So. Okay, thanks, Convener.
Right, is it on? Right, sorry about that. I suppose following on a wee bit from what Douglas is saying, I mean, we've spent a large part of this session looking and evaluating the complexity of your scrutiny and our scrutiny. And as you pointed out, Mark, a lot of it, we start to understand it and it's already passed. So I want to kind of think about something going forward. And I'm struggling to get my head around this from my sort of former life being very clear in management terms of the difference between accountability and responsibility. And I see this sort of writ large here because we've got the Scottish Government accountable for spend outcomes via the National Performance Framework, which we've talked about today, but has no responsibility in other areas. We've got this curious situation where the Scottish Government is accountable for these outcomes, but have no responsibility for efficient and effective delivery. We've got the UK Government responsible, but reluctant or have no accountability whatsoever in this place. When we then look forward at the replacement for EU structural funds that we already have on the record will be spent by the UK government direct to local councils, administered by a local government minister. I think it was the English Communities Minister. How on earth do you start to audit for that effectively? I can see you're thinking this is already a belter, but it's very complex, I think. How on earth do you audit for that? How are you reflecting on that additional complexity going forward when you link it back to outcomes?
Thank you. Good morning. I'm happy to start on that, and I'm sure Mark will want to come in as well. It is undoubtedly complex, and I think the example you use on the changes to European funding following the UK's departure from the European Union and what happens with those funding streams and what they're replaced by. We're tracking that closely because we don't yet know the answer and don't yet know what the associated audit arrangements will be. We had a very clear role in that up until now, whereby part of our audit work took us into the auditing of how the European Common Agricultural Funding was spent in Scotland. We worked closely with the other UK audit agencies to audit that. And alongside the structural fund changes as well, we don't yet know how that's going to be spent, whether it's going to be spent by directed by the UK government into local authorities, or what role the Scottish government will have. We are clear that we're continuing to track and monitor. It's a conversation that I had with the Public Audit Committee in recent weeks about the audit arrangement. But I think it's an example about that there is a remaining volatility in the system as to how public money is being spent and whether it's been spent by the UK government, the Scottish government or local authorities. And I think that led us to a point that we make in this paper about where possible, the need for effective communication and cooperation between the different spheres of government so that there is that level of clarity and transparency about what public money has been spent and what's been achieved by it. But we recognise the point you make, Ms. Thompson, that it is complex.
Thank you. I was recognising when you were asking the question there about how complex it is. And I think that's there's no getting away from that. And there's also an increasing ambiguity, wavy line about what's devolved and what's reserved and how those two spheres of government interact with one another. And you've given an example about how that has been further blurred around some of the funding streams. And there is an accountability challenge for the Parliament, for us as Audit Scotland, and others involved as to unpick and work our way through that. Some of that is relatively straightforward in that the spending bodies that are devolved spending bodies, wherever they get their money from, falls into the remit of either the Auditor General or the Accounts Commission as an opportunity to look how those spending bodies spend the money that's available to them and manage that. Where it gets more difficult is exactly at the root of your question about when that aggregates up and what's government in the round responsible for, and where again, there's a partnership agreement between government and local government and other bodies to deliver on the aims of the National Performance Framework and the outcomes that are in place. And that's where the real challenge is. I guess one of the things that the Auditor General's recommended in the past touches on this question and one or two of the others that came up before is that what's missing from the system at the moment, and the Deputy First Minister touched on it a little bit when you had him in front of you recently, is that annual report of, well, how's all that going from a government perspective? What's this year's narrative? What's this year's assessment of performance? And we think there's a real opportunity, yes, recognising the difficulty and the complexity of accountability, but pulling back from all that, from a government perspective, I think you asked convening earlier, what's government's contribution to outcomes and how are they responding to that? We think there's a real opportunity to add a further layer of reporting to help explain that, not because it's simple to do, but it's important to do that given the complexity that you set out.
Thank you both for that. And so following on from the problem, we all agree that we don't know till the data's there. And obviously that fits into your function. But getting the right balance between retrospective assessment and future forecasting, particularly when we adhere to good principles around accountability and responsibility, can I ask if you have any plans to put some meat on the bones of how that will make your role of, and our role of scrutiny more complex? It may be that as you start to get more information coming through, that you'll also consider reflecting on that, because it's beyond complex already, and this will be complex cubed, in my humble opinion.
Yeah, it's all of those things, isn't it? And it is that right balance between the retrospective look, you know, where audit has most traditionally found itself, and also then about the financial sustainability of Scotland's public finances, and we have a role in that alongside others. You know, so we've talked already this morning about the Fiscal Commission's plans for that really longer term analysis of the financial sustainability of Scotland's public finances, and then the government's own reporting through the medium-term financial strategy, the improved connections that makes to outcomes through the national outcomes. So we think that's a necessary component. For us, we'll always look to strike that balance between through the traditional audit work, so through the audit of over 200 plus public bodies that are spending the money that the Parliament approves. Much of that is reported directly through the individual public bodies. We then complement that with a suite of performance reporting, some of which Mark has drilled into, that explains in a bit more detail about some of those budget lines, whether it's on the NHS, education, or other aspects of the pandemic pound. But the point you make is quite right, is that we're in a really volatile environment, some of the changing nature of accountabilities, and for us, that we'll continue to track and report on that. One of the things that I think that we've mentioned through previous tracker reports is that we flexed our own approach in recent times too, that historically we would have had an annual programme of performance reports, and that would have been relatively fixed, but here are the lines of budget spend, here are the areas that we plan to report on. Pretty clear through the early stages of the pandemic that wasn't going to serve as well to reflect the volatile environment that we're in. So we now have a quarterly opportunity to refresh that, to deprioritise and to increase the priority around other areas. And that's something that we keep under review through our regular reporting.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Michelle. Just a couple of questions just to finish up for myself. And You've said in the report that the tracking of spend is more straightforward across health and social care and the larger support schemes. Outside of these, judgments have been made about how COVID-19 disruption to spending on services has been recorded. And I'm just wondering how this has varied. Has there been a consistency or inconsistency of approach across the directorates throughout the COVID-19 pandemic?
I'm happy to start. I'm sure Mark will say a bit more about some of the conversations and evidence that we've received from government. I think really the point that we make, Convener, that's led us to, that it has been much clearer in health and social care as through the use of Barnett consequentials. Some of the spending announcements have tracked into those, whether it's for additional PPE, would very clearly become health and social care related. Some of the support for local government, similarly, which is one of the other very significant components of the spending that's taken place, has been much more clearly ring-fenced, identifiable against previous budget heads. Some of the others, though, we think it's been a reasonable position and a reasonable reflection of the report, is that judgment has had to be used to map some of the 300-odd spending announcements to particular budget lines. So there's a sense of that's a fair thing that's had to be done. But in terms of some of the specifics against that, we think there's a need for a kind of clearer process. And once the volume of those changes ebbs, I don't know if Mark wants to say a little bit more about how we arrived at that judgment.
So as part of the work that we're planning to do, I think these are the sort of questions we'll look to get more evidence about and work through that. I think inevitably, given the degree of judgment that's been exercised, we would anticipate there was a degree of inconsistency, but also recognise that, and again, this is something we'll look to test in evidence, that how things develop through time changed. So that when the pandemic hit and there was a need to spend and support public services quickly, we would expect that environment to be different from 12 months in, 18 months in terms of those sort of questions. So I think one of the things we'll look to uncover is how did that change through time, and how reasonable was that by way of approach?
My last question. I mean, first of all, Stephen, you've basically said that there's been a variation through necessity as much as anything else. But with regard to what you've just recently said, Mark, have reporting mechanisms and transparency improved, stayed the same, or deteriorated over the pandemic? The hint there was that it had actually, although you said earlier on another layer of reporting would be helpful, but you have said it has improved over the last 18 months. Would it be fair to say that? Or do you feel that it hasn't improved? If it has improved, it hasn't improved as well as it perhaps could have. What would be your view on that?
I think we'll both offer a view on that. Yeah. I suppose the reference point would be difficult to say as a fair comparator. Through 2019... you'd say that there is a range of, compared to where we are now, there'd be a range of improvements and deterioration given the scale of change. So I think it's difficult at this stage to say that, to form definitive judgments around the quality of budget management and reporting, just reflecting the complexity that's taken place. Convener, my sense would be it probably feels too soon to make that kind of judgment. And with a degree of empathy that I think that we're trying to bring, this recognising just the scale of change and pace of spending that was taking place. It will take a while yet before we're in a position to say whether there has been improvement or deterioration.
Mark?
So I absolutely recognise that. I guess we're doing the work that will give us the evidence base to report a conclusion on that and some other areas. I think a couple of observations I would share. One is, in that list of things you asked us about there, Convener, I think there are different responses to different elements of that, just to pick out a couple of them. So in terms of financial management and how government has managed, I would expect, and we've yet to gather the evidence, I would expect that would be improved through time. And we've seen some evidence engaging with government that will be the case, and we'll look to explore that a bit more. I'd also reflect that in terms of transparency, there was a particular period from around December last year through the last budget process into February, March this year, where I think the height of transparency and the level of detail that the Cabinet Secretary was able to share about spending plans and COVID-related matters reached its peak. I would recognise that in advance of, and we've yet to digest the autumn budget revision, that that information, that level of information, was perhaps dropped off a bit for understandable reasons, new parliament, new government, etc. And I would hope that it would return to that level of articulation and level of transparency about where this money is going and what it's been used for.
Okay, well, thank you. That's very helpful. And indeed, all your evidence has been very helpful. I'm sure I speak on behalf of the committee in saying that. Without further ado, I'd like to terminate this public session of the committee to allow our witnesses and official report to leave, and we'll reconvene at noon.